Yes.
Just getting my chat out. Doesn't look like we're live yet. Are we live? We might be live.
There, you are live. I just heard you.
Oh, okay.
I heard you say, are we live yet?
Well, I guess that means I'm live. Hello, everyone. My goodness, we've had a lot of early access members show up this morning. Must be everyone really champed at the bit to watch my Baldur's Gate 3 review, I expect, which currently only members can view.
Ooh, get on it. Get on it, Internet.
And meanwhile, the rest of you are stuck with this dowdy little indie game ceremony. Anyway, welcome to the Posey P stream. I'm Yahtzee Croshaw. Jack's here. Hi, Jack.
Hi, Yahtzee. I'm here to talk to you about your indie games that you reviewed.
Well, they're not my indie games, but sure.
The indie games that you reviewed.
Starting with Viewfinder, which is a game that's like Portal. It's got an interesting central mechanic that it does puzzles around. And there's also a bit of a plot. But that'll emerge as we explore.
What would you estimate as the total length of Viewfinder playthrough?
If you're still doing all like the optional missions.
No, I mean, just like, oh, you're picking it up, you start to end, you know, not necessarily fiddling around, not necessarily not fiddling around. Your average, if you could estimate.
You'd probably be done inside an afternoon.
Okay, so maybe like a four-hour game.
Yeah, it's very much a Portal sort of length.
Sure.
Portal 1, that is.
Your vitals look good. Well, if I remember correctly, you know, like I had a big issue with Superliminal, as I thought like the shtick got old real dang fast.
Look, one of the mechanics in this game is that I can rewind time. Remember when you used to be able to base a whole game around something like that?
Oh, remember the first of the one shtick indie games.
What was the first game that did that? Prince of Persia: Sands of Time, maybe.
Oh, I was thinking, what was the Jonathan Blow super indie, like Xbox
Braid.
Arcade? Braid, yeah. Yes. That was the first big one where that was the central mechanic.
Okay, you ready to be astounded by the central mechanic of this game?
I am watching with bated breath and anticipation.
Okay, see this picture I've got?
Uh-huh. Whoa, yeah, that's really neat.
I made it real. Try to ignore the voiceover. It doesn't really add much.
Luckily, I can't hear it from my perspective. It seems incredibly cool.
Yeah, I mean, I first saw this game when I watched the demo at the Mix event at GDC. And of all the games at the event, this was the one that made us go, wow, that's amazing. How are you even doing that? That's mad.
Yeah.
Much like how everyone reacted when they saw the tech demos for Superliminal, funnily enough.
Oh, it's a very strong visual mechanic. You know, like it's very impressive. Like it's perfect for like the GIF sale, where you see a GIF on social media and say, "I am going to add that to my Steam wish list," and then you forget what game it was by the time it actually is out. Well, this is fun.
Yeah, you can tilt the photos as well.
Ooh.
Turn it upside down and go crazy.
What I think, you know, like my particular issue with Superliminal, which, you know, much like this, was very, very, I was super impressed as I began, and then as the puzzles went on and on and on, I stopped looking at the visuals and started looking at the mechanics and saying, oh, I think this is what the game wants me to do. Oh, yeah, that's what I'm doing. Instead of, like, being immersed in the puzzle.
Yeah. I think with this sort of thing where it's got a really impressive central puzzle mechanic, the sort of the wow factor sort of drops off.
Yeah.
And you got to sort of follow that up with something. And that's what Portal did. It followed it up with sort of a plot twist. And it actually had some really clever jokes, really clever writing. And Superliminal and this game don't really have anything to sort of turn into once you get bored of the actual mechanic.
Right. Right, and that was my reason for not buying and playing this particular game. And I also believe that, like, Portal as a game is something that you can complete in under an hour.
If you're speedrunning it, maybe.
I think speedrunners can complete it in like 7 minutes. Hold on, now I'm
Well, speedrunners are nuts. I mean, okay, if you're like a not a speedrunner, but you're just like replaying it because you want to wallow in the nostalgia,
sure.
Then I'd say I don't think it would be like under an hour. Maybe like an hour and a half, 2 hours.
Okay, yeah, and going to howlongtobeat.com, they are saying like the average video gamer will spend about 3 hours.
Yeah.
In Portal.
I mean, I guess it depends if you know the solution to the puzzles as well.
Right, right. And so, like, I think, like, even at, like, you know, 4 to 6 hours, that might be too long for these games, where it's like, you know, get in, tell your joke, get out, and let people revel in that.
Yeah, if you haven't got, like, a really interesting plot to engage us beyond that point.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
This is the level where we learn how to use Sky. Sky, in this context, is basically just nothing. You use it to replace something with nothing.
Oh, that's very fun. How to use Sky.
Yes. It's important to know how to use Sky in this game. Yeah.
That is really impressive looking.
I know.
It just rips off half of the building.
Probably why the demo did really well.
I mean, it looks great. It looks great. I guess, you know, the other part of it for me, and you know, like, I cannot speak to this game as I have not played it, but, you know, the, like, thinking on the reasons why I didn't pull the trigger and buy the game is, like, Portal gave me a sense of, like, sure, there was a way to beat this puzzle, but I could fuck around a little bit. Like, I could find my way to beat the puzzle sort of thing. Oh, paradox stabilization failed. What does that mean?
Well, this is the plot thing.
Oh.
You see, we're exploring a virtual world.
Oh.
In a holodeck thing.
Oh, here it is. Here it is. Let's see here. E1 Crazy 4 Life, thanks for the $4.99 American, who says, what factors determine whether two games are reviewed as part of an indie double bill?
If they're not very long games, and if I played both of them in my week for playing games. Is about the rub of it. I'm playing Sea of Stars at the moment. That's probably going to be a game reviewed by itself, because it's quite long. So, yeah, the thing is, we're a researcher and we're investigating an old VR world created by some kind of genius tech cult. And we're looking for the solution to climate change, which, as you can see, has become a bit of a sticking point in the sci-fi future.
The solution to climate change is somewhere within the VR world.
Well, that's the rub, yes. That's what we think. And nice for some contrived reason, like we have to solve puzzles to reach it.
Sure. You know what? And I'm okay with that. Like, I'm definitely 100% down with, for some reason, you have to solve puzzles to figure it out. Like, that's just game. So I'm going to be okay with that. I'm going to be okay with that. Ero Lang, thanks for the €5, who says, Yahtzee, I've recently listened to your Galaxy books through Audible for the first time and enjoyed them very much. Any plans for third book?
More than plans. We've finished the first draft pretty much. It's probably going to be recording it soon. It's with the copy editor at the moment.
Ooh, very exciting. Those are wonderful books. I enjoy them very much.
Knowing Audible, they like to get this stuff done expediently. It's not like print publishing. Jesus Christ. You're waiting upwards of a year before the thing finally comes out.
Should be smooth sailing from here. Hopefully.
Oh, now you're back in.
Yeah.
Because now that you've gotten to glimpse what the real world is.
Yeah, which was intriguing. So it's kind of a shame that we never really go back to the real world. And the whole rest of the game's just in the VR space.
Well, that was, you know, that was part of the fun of Portal is like that slow discovery of what was outside of your test chambers.
Yeah.
And obviously, like, you can't duplicate that. Like, you can't just hit those same notes. But again, you want like the players to discover something, I guess.
Right, and the only thing left for this game to discover is that all the people who run this virtual world are kind of obnoxious, smug twats.
Oh, terrible. Fungus Finder, thanks for the $5 American, who says Portal's plot is unduplicable. I don't know if unduplicable is a word.
Inimicable?
Ooh.
Was that the word we were after there?
You know what? I'll accept either. Both sound like very fake words. Fungus Finder goes on to say, it's like the Sixth Sense or some other twist. Once you've experienced it, that's it. How do you recreate that?
I guess you don't. You just come up with another twist for the next one.
Right.
Ooh, visual styles, arty, etc.
Visual, you know, like for example, like, and this is me pulling something right out of my ass, right? But and you know, going along the arty farty path is you are playing this game, and we slowly discover that it was your dead parents' favorite game, or they programmed it and they left hidden messages for you. Boom.
Right. Right. Yeah, that doesn't happen.
Right, right. But yeah, but like we get a slow reveal of like, oh, this simple puzzle game has a deeper meaning.
Oh, yeah, well, the theme of this game is sort of like tech bros are really cool and you should let them make their amazing creative projects because they will save the world. And I think that particular message has sort of been tainted of late.
Was this game like funded by like Meta or something?
I don't think so. I want to say maybe this might have been like a British game because there's a lot of British and Scottish voice actors.
Hmm.
I'm not sure though.
All right, Dr. Zebra, I'll read this. This is a weird one. Dr. Zebra, thanks for the $5 American. Yahtzee, what do you say to the rumors that you've been donating to the Westboro Baptist Church for years? Rumors I'm just now making up.
Oh, Westboro Baptist Church. That takes you back. That hasn't been like a thing for years. That was like the God Hates Fags dudes, right?
Yeah, they're still out there, as far as I know.
I think that like the dude who was the head of the Cult of Personality died.
That's
the thing about cults of personality. They don't really survive past the personality very long.
I think, like, people got hip to their shtick, because if I remember correctly...
I'll get hip to your shtick.
Oh, it's hip to be shtick. Bam, bandana down. If I remember correctly, one of their main sources of revenue was suing people for assault. Like, they would purposefully put themselves in situations in which they would make people so upset that they would be assaulted. And then they would, like, sue them for money. And people got really wise to their con. And right. So maybe some of the money dried up.
Ooh, new mechanics. Hang on.
Oh, okay. Hang on. Hanging on.
A picture of a battery. But we need two batteries for the machine.
Oh.
So we go to this photocopier.
A photocopier? What's us to doubt?
Yeah, let's see if we can...
so we go to a photocopier.
Yay.
That's great. That's hilarious.
Let's do this without having to touch the batteries. There we go.
Very, very fun. Josh, who's been a member for 27 months, thank you for that support. Josh, Jack, long time no see. Seen anything good lately? I've seen Oppenheimer. Oppenheimer's very good.
Is it?
I really think it is. And I, in general, I hate biopics. Right. And I'm not a big Christopher Nolan fan at all. And I fucking... And it's long. It's a three-hour movie. I do not like long movies. So it had three strikes against it. It overcame all of that. It's fucking brilliant.
I am intrigued because, you know, if there's three things that would probably turn me off a film, it would be being 3 hours long and being a biopic.
Yep.
And being depressing.
Yes.
Everyone says that this film sort of transcends all that.
It's I could very easily, I probably am going to watch it again. Like, I'm going to go to the theaters and sit down for another 3 hours to watch it again. It is a high quality filmmaking.
Well, I do like Cillian Murphy.
Oh, he's so good. I mean, the everyone in the cast is phenomenal. Like, Robert Downey Jr., I want to say Darren mentioned this in his review, like his turn towards, like, I'm going to play, like, you know, big, you know, prestige roles now that I'm no longer Iron Man. It was great. It was, all phenomenal, all, like, wonderful encapsulation of this, like, theme of did I, you know, like, the complication of creating, you know, the atom bomb. So... it's quite beautiful and remarkable.
And I'm just still thinking about how pretty Cillian Murphy is. How much I really like that one scene in Batman Begins where Scarecrow does fear gas on the mob boss dude.
Ooh, yeah, that's a good one. An artificial record keeper. That is a good one. You're gonna if you think Cillian Murphy's pretty, you're gonna like this. One, it's a lot of close-ups of Cillian.
Yeah. Yeah, and I know there's, like, a sex scene in it, apparently.
Oh, there's multiple sex scenes. Oppenheimer fucks.
Well, you would. You would, wouldn't you? If you half suspect you're about to light the atmosphere on fire.
This must be the next. Oh, he fucks way before that. Oh, it's great. It's great. I saw it with my eldest child and with my mother-in-law. And, you know, my oldest is 15 now. And so, you know, he's getting into more and more, you know, grown-up movies. But I did have to, like, talk to him where I was like, hey, as a heads up. Oh, that's neat.
Perspective
fuckery. I said, like, as a heads up, there is, you know, some sex scenes in this. There is some nudity. I'm not saying that, you know, it's going to be weird, but you are seeing it with your dad and with your grandma. So I just want to mentally prepare you that we're going to see titties. And it wasn't weird. It was good. It was a good movie. So,
well, what's to be embarrassed about titties? We've all got one.
It's a natural thing.
Some of us have got two.
Ooh, how exciting. Are we?
I mean, we've all played Baldur's Gate 3. We all understand unflinching nudity. It's me. I don't know how it
happened. Somehow I lost direct. So many wangs. Fugan, thank you for being a member for 15 months to the tip jar. We appreciate that support. Denmark, thanks for the $2 American, who says Cult of Personality is now stuck in my head. You're welcome. It's a great fucking song.
I remember playing the Guitar Hero version.
Oh, fuck. That's just a song to get you amped, get you pumped. Little Living Color. Hell yeah. Asti Foo, thanks for the $10 American, who says, hey, Jack, just wanted to give you a tip for the hilarious voice work in Adventure is Nigh for Toasty, the cookie familiar. Please keep it up with that voice as much as possible. Thank you, Asti Foo.
Oh, you ain't seen nothing yet.
Oh, I'm currently editing episode 4, and hoo boy, does it get weird.
Nah, we can't actually line up with the perspective thing because this bit of wall is in the way. So you need to use this bit of sky to get rid of this bit of wall. And then we can line up with the perspective image properly. It's a puzzle. This game has them. Okay,
but you messed... Did I see like that you kind of messed it up so you had to rewind before you deleted the wall?
Yes.
Ah, do that very, very fun.
Because of technology.
Because of game mechanics, Yahtzee. Game mechanics. Yeah, and that toasty voice was a coin toss. I was either going to go very, very silly... Or I was going to be as, like, smooth and deep as possible, like...
Barry White.
That was going to be my attempt, you know, just this very tiny cookie man, you know, going, hey there, Dabarella. and I made a split-second decision, day of recording, and I do not regret it.
Who's the famous actor that had that toasty voice first? Because a lot of people associate it with Snagglepuss.
Yeah.
Or the Mad Hatter from Disney's Alice in Wonderland.
And I want to say that that's the actor with the voice. Ed Wynn is his name. Ed Wynn is the person with that voice in several things. But yeah, Snagglepuss, Mad Hatter, Ed Wynn. Yeah, that's the voice.
So his name wasn't Edwin. It was Ed Wynn.
Correct. Ed W-Y-N-N. Ed Wynn.
Was his parents trying to take the piss or something?
His name is Edwin Ed, or his name is Edwin Wynn. Very, very funny. Fungus Finder, thanks for the $2 American. Why does warm for my form make me feel so nasty?
That's a line from my Baldur's Gate 3 review.
There you go.
Or is that? From the upcoming extra punctuation that hasn't come out yet. Well, it's a phrase I use occasionally.
And what does it mean, and should we feel nasty hearing it?
Well, you know, it means hot for my body. It's the sort of thing Mortimer would say. He would say, oh yeah, she's warm for my form.
Okay, no, that's fair. That's fair. I didn't know if that was just like a pure temperature thing. Like, no, I run hot. I get sweaty easily. Yeah. But that's fine. R. John, welcome to Early Access. Enjoy Baldur's Gate 3. Zero punctuation. Right now. Well, or after the stream. Go after the stream.
Or now. I mean, we're not your boss.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, well, you can do whatever you want. But also, like, if you want to watch a stream, it's fun too. And XYF... I won. Also, welcome to Early Access. We appreciate that support. John Connor, thanks for the $5 Canadian, who says, I feel these games need to be longer than just an hour, or else it hardly seems worth the price of a game unless it's $10 to $15.
See, I think of the Talos Principle. That was actually pretty long.
Okay.
But I've forgotten most of it. It had a lot of different ideas for puzzles, but they were all like on the theme of. I don't think there was any like seriously crazy new game mechanics in that. It was just push crates to put on buttons and stuff.
Ugh. So they went full 2D Zelda.
Kinda.
Just push crates. Yeah, pricing is really difficult, right? Right now. You can go watch Oppenheimer for $12 here in Wisconsin, right? 3 hours worth of entertainment for $12. A game you have a possibility of replaying, of being longer, and so it's about, you know, dollar per hour of fun, right? That's always the calculation.
Which is a little reductive.
Of course it's reductive. To the simulation. Yeah. there's no other way to do it, and you can only price things as other things are priced, or it's going to seem strange. As Yahtzee pointed out in his wonderful review that I saw today for this very game, pointing out that You know, games should be shorter, games should be more expensive, and games should take longer to produce, just so, you know, we don't burn out the wonderful talent that's making all of these things. So I'm also on that team. Let's... Whoa. So you have to take a picture of the camera to take a picture of the camera.
Yeah,
to get
so you can,
to the exit.
So you can turn it the other way so you can get to the exit.
Yeah, I like it. I like it.
I'd like to help you.
Do, do, do. Also, yes, food, please. Says, note, reviewers have to play games and would prefer they be short. Yes.
Well, that's true. But at the same time, I think we can all agree that we don't like a game that wastes our time.
Right.
Especially if you just have to, like, do the same thing for hours on end to advance in the plot. Or go through incredibly long, pointless dungeons.
Hmm. Correct. A game... I guess any form of art should never outstay its welcome. That's the real key to this, is not outstaying your welcome. Where I've heard, you know, a Baldur's Gate 3, from what I've heard about it, you know, it has this, you know, incredible story, a ton of fiddly things, so many hours, but every single hour is packed full of interesting content. That's what I've heard. I have not played it, or I've not played it past early access.
Well, I've played most of the first act of it.
Ooh.
And there sure is a lot of stuff in it.
And so that's all we're saying. Going back to that, you know, fun, you know, fun per hour price.
Hey.
Dollar per fun of hour price is like, am I grinding? Am I farming in order to level up my character? Or is this game filled with interesting things?
It wasn't so much grind for me. It's just that some of the combat scenes took so bloody long. Because the enemy AI is very good at just completely fucking you over.
Sure.
Like, first time one of them just ran over and just bodied me into a lava pit. I was like, hey, that's my party member. I need him.
Hey, that was mean.
I mean, I know I've been bodying enemies into lava pits a lot, but, you know, some of them have such big health bars. It makes things so much easier.
You can't do my trick. That's my trick. Like when an enemy heals, like, wait a minute, you're not supposed to be able to do that. So yeah, it's just about wasting time. It's not about length. There's been plenty of short games that I felt wasted my time.
Now, you see, what we did here is that activating the fifth force perspective thing has cut off the platform from the battery.
Oh.
So now we can't use it. But we were smart enough to take a picture of it before we cut it off. So now we can just use that one.
Ha ha ha. Very nice.
Oh shit, we need two batteries. Hang on.
Wait a minute. The game tricked me. Between Dredge, this is George Lucas, says, between Dredge and Viewfinder, I liked Dredge more. I would think those are two very different games.
Well, yes. Dredge is not really puzzly.
Right. Dredge is a very good game. I enjoyed Dredge quite a bit.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Your mistake there is sort of conflating all indie games under one umbrella.
Right. Apples and oranges, my friend. Apples and oranges. Do you offset that money per hour comparison for things like games, Jack? Games require you to have $500 worth of equipment to use them. A movie doesn't. You just need those $12. Ah, ooh, very interesting analysis. Lampy, we've already said that. My dollar per hour of fun is incredibly reductive in simplifying a much larger conversation. But you are correct in that, like, part of that calculation of dollar per hours of fun has to go to whatever system you are playing that on. Oh, ha, ha. So, I do think that's it's an interesting thing. Pricing games will always be an incredible hot button issue, as far as I'm concerned, because nothing will ever be good enough. And in general, we need to pay everybody more of everything, but no one wants to pay more for anything. So we're going to be stuck in that cycle for a long time.
Yes.
Forever, maybe.
But I wish this writer's strike would stop. I'm waiting to sell my blockbuster screenplay to Hollywood for billions.
You're going to scab it up. Scab it. Don't you fucking scab, you hot.
I ain't no scab.
Yeah, that's right.
That's why I haven't shown anyone or told anyone or actually written it yet. Solidarity, brothers.
Yeah, that's right. I was going to act in the next Marvel movie, even though no one asked me to, but I'm not gonna, because I'm with the unions. Great. Let's see. Where are we? Asti Fu, a member of bonus content for 39 months. Thank you for that support. Oh, hey, I've never sent this before. 39 months is good. Everyone at The Escapist, keep up the great work. We will do our best.
Will do.
We'll do our absolute best. Captain President, thanks for the $5 tip, who says, Mariam Chaudhry says, Yahtzee, I'm going to make Mortimer an NPC in my D&D game. What tips do you have for role-playing him?
Well, I guess the essence of Mortimer is that not to play him so much as a deceitful, clever con artist, but as someone who self-identifies as someone who's cleverer than everyone else and may or may not be right.
I like that.
Also, you might want to watch through season 3 because certain things are revealed that might give a certain amount of depth to Mortimer's attitude. We sort of explain why he has such a difficult relationship with telling the truth.
Oh, I can't wait to get to those episodes. I can't wait to revisit those episodes during editing. Mm. Some stuff goes down.
So it was quite a Mortimer-y season. I was very gratified, but I'm looking forward to sort of taking a back seat for the next one. Mortimer's gonna chill for a bit.
Oh, you've earned it. You've definitely earned it. Plans. I've already started doing a bit of writing for the next side quest and for season 4. Some very fun ideas. Obviously, there's only so much I can do before all of my players say no thanks. We want to go do our own thing. So,
any concrete plans for season 4 at the moment? I don't suppose it's going to be another in-person one.
There have been talks of things, is all I can say.
Are we finally going to Hawaii? The less burnt parts.
We're going to... we've been... I cannot confirm or deny anything as far as season 4 is concerned. What I can say is we've been looking at physical spaces.
Ooh, nice.
So... But anything is possible. Plans change all the time. Side Quest 3, we will film before that. That will be another online one, because that's significantly easier.
Because it's just a side quest.
It's just a side quest.
But that's the one me and KZ will be on, because we didn't get to be on the last one, so it's only fair.
100%. I don't know if we've announced who the other players will be yet.
You want to? I mean, it's your show, man.
Right? Do I want to? We'll save that. We'll save that for another. We'll make you come back the next time I'm live streaming, and we'll announce it then. So to recap, in order to play a good Mortimer, you need to believe you are very smart, even though you might not necessarily be. Also, Mortimer, I feel, is a character that is very of the moment. So try not to think of any future consequences. What will get you through the next 5 minutes? That is your primary concern. That's how I've always seen Mortimer. That may or may not be true.
Interesting. It's interesting to get another person's perspective. I don't think I've ever seen him that way. I think of him as a schemer to a certain extent. And when like he has to suddenly act on the fly, he starts to get flustered.
Yeah, but he's flustered a lot, in my opinion. So.
So now we've got a camera. We can take our own things.
Oh, so many batteries. Yes.
Let's make more trees. Yes, because we can.
Alec, I hate when a second book is a prequel. Too scared to go forward, don't you? Unrelated, I just finished Wool on your recommendation and can't wait to see the characters continue their journey in Shift. What a very funny joke, Alex.
I was thinking of Resident Evil when they said that.
The second book in the Silo series, Shift, I guess, you know, maybe not a spoiler, is a prequel.
Oh, that's disappointing.
What I've said a lot is both Shift and the third one is called something else, I forget. Neither of them are, in my opinion, like as poignant as Wool is. The momentum of Wool carried me through them both very, very easily.
Yeah,
so I really.
Yeah, I've only read Wool, but it was pretty good. But some people only have one good book in them, and maybe this was one of those cases.
You know.
Maybe it was a Catcher in the Rye situation.
I enjoyed all of the Silo series.
Not Catcher in the Rye. What am I thinking of? To Kill a Mockingbird?
To Kill a Mockingbird,
yeah,
Harper Lee.
Harper Lee wrote one book, and then like a million years later she wrote another. It was just To Kill a Mockingbird again.
It was just re-examining To Kill a Mockingbird, yes. What I'll say is, if you liked Wool a lot, both the second and third books in the Silo series, you will enjoy. You might not enjoy as much. I've liked his other, Hugh Howey's other books as well. Sand is a really fun one. Sand is a little more fun. And, he has a really weird one about deep space travel that I also enjoyed. So, he's just an author I like, so I like his voice.
Has he considered writing a book with more than four letters in the title?
It's getting harder and harder to reach you.
That's like next. That's next, that's a lot.
That's how you wrap things up for the sequel.
Ooh.
Ooh, a six-letter word, dare we dream?
Dust. It's Wool, Shift, Dust. Those are the Silo series.
I feel like in this day and age, when you do that, you're just making your book harder to Google.
That is fair. Beacon 23. That is the. Oh wait. Oh, maybe that is not. I'm trying to look up his other books here. Halfway Home. That's what it is. Halfway Home is his deep space one that I thought was pretty darn good. And Sand, I enjoyed a lot. These other ones I haven't read. I haven't read Beacon 23. So. Maybe we'll get on that. I don't know. We'll see. Fungus Finder, Jack, where exactly did Mortimer get that Stone of Truth? I know that, and Yahtzee knows that, and no one else knows that.
Yes, it's part of his backstory. It's very poignant.
Mm-hmm. Very poignant. A nice, wondrous, magical object. Oh, Nick is in the chat. We have not discussed who's going to be in Side Quest, as it's too early. I mean, we know who's going to be in Side Quest.
Yeah.
We just haven't said it out loud yet.
We've put everyone in a Slack room and everything.
a A Donald Trumpler, welcome to Early Access. We appreciate that support, though it took me a little bit longer to understand your username than I would care to admit.
Is that referencing something?
Well, the ex-president's name is in there.
Yeah, I got that part.
Trumpler. So I don't know. It might be a reference to something. I don't get it. Just took me a little bit to understand what those words were supposed to be. And that's okay.
Just trying to figure out. I mean, we could, theoretically, we could do pretty much anything to get up there. Like, just randomly photograph this bit of railing.
Mm-hmm.
And then tilt it. And then walk up it.
Oh. Oh, did you make it too tilty?
Might have done.
Uh-oh. Then that's not going to work.
Hey!
You did it! You did it. By the way, Jack, great Galaxy Brain for Adventures 9, Season 3, Episode 2. There were a lot of moments there. Oh, first of all, look at that little Zelda screenshot. That's adorable. That is adorable.
This reminds me of, do you ever play the remake of Link's Awakening on the Switch?
Oh, sure.
This was how they ever had to do the 3D art, basically, with everything sort of weirdly slanted backwards and tilted up towards the camera, because that's the only way it works from that perspective. Yes. Quick. Ooh. Let's do this quick smart. Paf.
Quick. Who?
Paf.
Whoa.
Teleport.
Wow. Very nice. Very nice. Yeah, the for anyone who has seen episode 2 of season 3, that's when the players absolutely broke any sort of ideas of what I had of what was going to happen during that season. And
should have known we'd want to go and have fun with our anus.
Like that's fine. Where it's like, oh yeah, I can do some bits. I can make up Jesse and I had to kind of make up a little anus Grinderbin trade deal, which was very fun. Like, oh yeah, this is kind of how this works. That sort of thing. But yeah, then the other stop and then the incredible dump. The incredible dump.
The lesser known Marvel superhero.
I have the amazing power to release as much excrement from my anus as I desire.
Well, that sounds a little crass.
Well, I'm sorry, that's my superpower. I can't help that. I believe I have the latter end of a wormhole inside my body, and I'm able to just release anything, any amount of excrement. Flashy superpower.
I guess you couldn't help it. It's just weird to come out here and broadcast it to everyone, you know?
Well, it's not like I can hold down a regular job. I can, I can poop as long as I want. I figure there's got to be a way to make money off of this.
But you can always just not do that, right? And then just get a job at the Starbucks.
Well, yeah, sure, but superheroes seem to be pretty popular, pretty in fashion at the moment. Thought I'd take advantage. So here I am. What do you need poop done?
This riff, for a start. But, you might be a bit late. I think we've thoroughly shat on it enough already.
Ooh, and scene. That's great.
And this kind of fun and more can be had on Adventurers Nigh every other week. Tune in. Or miss out.
Tune in or miss out. That's, that's a thing I definitely enjoy is like expanding on the reality of the world that we make, where it's like, we say something and that it is true, and we all have to believe that it is true for the rest of our time in this world. right? And I think that's where like the magic of improv and math comes together with Dungeons and Dragons.
Hmm. Fair enough.
Phil, my ass up. Thanks for the 20 knock. Who says, do you have a plan / will to review Skylines 2?
Probably not. Didn't even know they were doing a Skylines 2.
Oh, well, there you go.
I don't really get on with that sort of city management stuff. I prefer things to be more goal-oriented, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
Just like, hey, I made a city, now what? Just feels like I'm drawing in MS Paint or something. Except with roads.
I have fond memories of Sim City, but most of my Sim City time was spent like at school while I was supposed to be doing other work. So I don't know if it was the actual game or the fact that I was playing games while I was supposed to be doing work that got me into Sim City.
Well, it's great, those games that look like work, aren't they? Oh, hang on.
Oh.
I think I just erased a battery from existence.
You sure did. Incognito Lens, thanks for the $10 American, who says, Jeff Varnamere's book Annihilation has overshadowed his other work so much that review blurbs on all his other books are comprised exclusively of unrelated random praise for Annihilation.
Was that the one that film was based on?
I'm using context clues to assume that.
Am I thinking of the... Was it called Annihilation? That film with...
Yeah, Natalie Portman.
Yeah,
and
Natalie Portman and the dude who was in Star Wars. Oh, yeah. I guess Natalie Portman was in Star Wars as well.
Yeah.
I guess everyone's been in Star Wars by this point. That doesn't narrow it down.
Based off of the 2014 novel of the same name. Correct.
Huh. Didn't even know it was a novel.
Mm. It's a wonderfully visual movie. So I'd be very curious... Actually, they probably handled a lot of the unsettling visuals better in the book, as you bring that as in your imagination. But that, it's funny. Like, oh, this one was such a big hit, and you cannot have any other work that is nearly as good. Sorry, Jeff.
All right, here's one for you. What do you call a melon that commits a crime?
Okay, so we got a watermelon... We got a cantaloupe. Oh, that's a marriage thing. You can't elope. You got a honeydew. A melon that can... Oh, I don't know. What do you call a melon that commits a crime?
A water felon. It's possible you were overthinking it.
I was trying to make a pun. I was trying to make like an actual joke happen here.
Well, what's that and not a pun?
You know, the classic, you know, why do melons have to get married? Because they can't elope.
I hadn't heard that one. That's pretty good.
That's classic. That's a classic right there.
What's the best kind of cheese for disguising a horse?
Ooh, what?
Mascarpone.
That's pretty good.
Oh, what's that one? All right.
Okay.
Arnold Schwarzenegger doesn't get any Easter eggs 1 year. And he looks very upset. But then his personal assistant comes up and says, does this mean you don't like Easter anymore, Mr. Schwarzenegger? And Arnold goes, no, I still love Easter, baby.
Oh, that's good. That's good. I enjoy that a lot. Hey, Yahtzee.
The rub of this puzzle is that we have to take a picture of the ending thingy, but if it's not connected to a power source, then it won't function. So we have to get the whole wire and the lever in the picture as well.
Very fun. Yahtzee, why should you wait to eat an asteroid... until after it enters the Earth's atmosphere?
I think I know this one. Is it something to do with it being meteor?
Because then it's meteor.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, we all saw that Futurama episode too.
Oh, that's from a Futurama episode? Oh, I thought I made that one up.
I'm sure you think you did make it up.
Well, you know.
It's very clever.
It's very, very clever. What's the most obvious greeting in Star Wars?
I give up. What's the most obvious greeting in Star Wars?
It's yo, duh.
I was expecting a lot more from you.
Oh, I liked that one. That's a good one. That's my favorite one. That's one that I think I wrote too. I'm sure someone else has also wrote it.
No, I don't think anyone would have had the low self-esteem to tell anyone else if they had thought of it.
I like coming up with puns. I like coming up with bad jokes. It's very fun. It's very fun for me.
Well, where are we?
Joke police is on the way. Okay, I got one more for you. Here's my last one that I think I wrote. I might not have, though.
Okay.
Which is, recently I took all my pets to obedience school, and my dog and cat are doing great, you know, all A's and B's, but my fish, they're all below sea level.
That's pretty good.
That's pretty...
I got a few that I didn't make up.
Oh, okay. All right.
That I forget where I heard them, but my dog Minton swallowed a shuttlecock.
Oh, really?
Badminton.
Yeah, I like that one. That's good. I see what you did there. These are funny. These are funny jokes. And I'm okay with it.
Oh, we're only 8 minutes away till we switch to the other game. For anyone who's already bored of this extraordinary new gameplay mechanic. Because we apparently were bored enough that we started making up shitty jokes instead of talking about it.
Well, yeah. Yeah,
It's a hard experience to share this sort of thing, because half of the pleasure is figuring out how to solve the puzzles.
Well, and maybe that was part of... The other part of, like, the portalness of Portal is it wasn't just puzzles. Like, there was also a component to Portal where you had to be good enough to solve it. Like, you could know where to place your portals and still fail. And so there was a mechanical challenge along with a puzzle challenge. And maybe that's the thing with all of these portal likes that people keep missing. That was a swift one, wasn't it? John Connor, thanks for the $5 Canadian, who says, why did the partially blind man fall into the well? Why? Because he just couldn't see that well.
Yeah, I've heard that one. I've also heard... I went to the zoo once. The only animal in it was a dog. It was a shit zoo.
These are funny. These are funny, and I like them all. Thank you, everyone, for sharing all of your jokes. Yeah, we'll be here all week. Hey. Is there any reason you're so reluctant to have good designs? That reminds I've told this story on streams before. I don't know if I've ever told them this one. It's like one of when I was younger, I'm still a big comedy fan in general, but I was really, really into stand up comedy and just like, you know, getting as much stand up comedy as I could. And one time on vacation there was like a hack stand up comic who, like, you know, he worked the tourist club, and like he'd be there every single night, you know, I'm sure doing the exact same material every single night. But for me as a youngster, I was in love with it. I thought it was hilarious. He had this one bit about wedlock, about getting married. Yeah, you'll never catch me getting married. Wedlock sounds a little too close to deadbolt. You know, go, you know, and like he had this whole marriage bit. And like for me as a younger person, I was like, this is it. This is the height of comedy. This is hilarious. Wedlock does sound like Deadbolt. That's the best.
That's very cute. That's a very cute image.
You know, like I might have been...
You just enraptured by a terrible stand-up comedian.
I was probably 12 and just thought it was hilarious.
Oh, what's that
and
joke?
This poor guy.
What's that joke? Marriage is an institution that requires commitment. I'm not quite sure I'm ready to be committed to an institution.
Oh! Right. So many jokes.
Hey.
Hold on. Chilfax says, oh shit, I used to be a full day comic as a kid.
That sounds exhausting.
What is a full day comic?
Do you mean class clown? Someone Maybe. Every other student wanted to punch?
Always thinking of wordplay and pranks. Turns out that's annoying for everyone around you. Yeah, I think that's it. Yeah, class clown. That. Yeah. A lot of us go down that route. You know. That's how a lot of us get into comedy. Is it's a way to ward off the bullies. They can't make fun of you if you're already making fun of yourself. Great. SVS Guru 2000, thanks for the €5, who says, I'm sure you'll enjoy hate this classic German joke. I'm not going to read that because I don't know what it says, SVS Guru.
Treffen sich zwei Jäger bei der Tod. Which I think means there were two hunters and one died. Hmm. Although I'm not sure if I'm entirely correctly translating that.
Hmm. I don't know. Phil, my ass up, thanks for the 50 nyuk, who says, want to know how to make a sausage roll? You push it down a hill.
Yeah.
I was insufferable in late grade school, early high school, like eighth, ninth grade, as I was, you know, the class clown. Mm-hmm. That was my shtick. And there's an escalation that needs to happen when you're the class clown. You have to keep being funnier. And so in high school, I went from a private Catholic school to the public high school, which was significantly larger, mostly new people, mostly people I didn't know before. So I needed to, in my head, I needed to up my game. So what I did was I had this like dark green, like a detective trench coat. That I sewed extra large pockets in the inside so I could fill it with props.
Well, there was no hope for you.
Oh god, no. And so like I would have rubber chickens and yo-yos and little magic tricks like whoopee cushions, just filled to the brim with joke props in case anyone needed a bit at any point. I had it in my pocket.
Did you do a Groucho Marx voice while you were pulling stuff out?
I'm sure.
I'm picturing it, and it makes me want to die.
Oh, I did. You might be surprised. Freshman year, I did not make any friends.
Were you like the class clown dude from Stephen King's It?
Oh, maybe. It's been a while. It's been a while since I've read or seen that, so I cannot tell you for sure. But oh yeah, it was. I was insufferable, as the class clown. And the only thing that stopped me from being that insufferable was finding short form improv comedy in high school. So I became insufferable in a different way with less props.
I see.
Yeah. So what are you going to do? That's, you know, we all learn these lessons. What are you going to do? King Dead 42. Thank you for the $2. Who says class clown with prop comedy? How did you survive? By myself. I survived by myself. No, I found comedy sports in high school, and I saw these people who were getting paid to be as goofy as I was, and I said, that's it. That's my goal. That's what I strive to do. Short form improv comedy, because that's what's really cool. And my school had a team. There was a high school league where you could, you know, be on a team and perform along with other high schools. And it was phenomenal for the next 4 years.
Oh, I see what I'm doing wrong now.
Oh.
Yeah, when I was a kid, I read, my parents got me The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy when I was like 8 years old. And that mm-hmm. pretty much defined my whole path in life as well.
Yeah.
I wanted to write funny books.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, 2 o'clock. Well, that was Viewfinder. There's more puzzles that you could maybe solve yourself. I ain't going to do it all for you.
Well, you know, there's walkthroughs, I'm sure. It'll be fine. You'll be fine. Juan.
No, figure it out yourself. That's how you have fun.
Absolutely.
It's fun to figure things out. That's why I like detective games.
Dang it. I was going to use the game switchover to show everyone my biscuit cam.
Oh, yeah. Show everyone the biscuit cam.
But here's the thing. Biscuit moved.
Oh.
Here's my biscuit camera. I had it specially set up because Biscuit was sleeping on his little bed in the corner of my office, and now he's behind my chair.
What a rascally biscuit you have.
So my cat, I was hoping to show you all my cat, but he has moved behind my chair.
I've met Jack's cat. I've picked up Jack's cat. He's a very fat cat.
Mm-hmm. Isn't he lovely? The answer is yes.
Isn't he lovely?
Chuan, welcome to Early Access. Sorry if I'm pronouncing your name wrong. That's how I am pronouncing it. Hunter Crinston, thanks for the 100 MXs. Now I want to know what an MX is.
Mexican things.
Let's see here. Yes, that is a peso, a Mexican peso. Thank you for the 100 pesos. I recently translated a ZP episode to Spanish for a college work, and even though I had issues keeping up with your voice, I give you my thanks for a perfect score.
Ooh, that can't have been an easy job. Hang on, I forgot to change the name on the overlay. There we go. We're playing My Friendly Neighborhood now, which is open quotes survival horror game in the increasingly popular mascot horror genre, started by Five Nights at Freddy's. Do you know much about this one?
Just what I've seen on the surface, which is that it was a. I assumed that this was a Five Nights at Freddy's like, but I've heard nothing but good things about it.
There's a bit more to it than that. I mean, it is a horror game where you get chased around by deadly puppets, but it's surprisingly family friendly, and at the end of the day, the ultimate message of it is kind of more Sesame Street played straight. It's like, hey, maybe we could be friends, and maybe everything will work out.
I love it. I love it. I'm a big proponent of aggressive optimism. So let's do it.
Where's my mouse pointer there?
That's a great question.
I wish it'd go away.
You can, I believe you can select it so that you hide your mouse cursor in whichever program you're using to capture the video. There should be an option that says hide mouse cursor. Theoretically. SVS Guru Who 2000, thanks for the €5. Translating the German joke for us. It means two hunters meet, both dead.
I assume as a joke it works better in the original language.
It's based on treffen, meaning both meet and hit a target.
Oh.
So like two hunters hit, both dead.
I thought it was something like that joke. A drum kit gets pushed off a cliff. Ba-dum-tish.
That's a good one. That's what a man walks into a bar.
Ouch. Yeah.
Iro Lang, thanks for the €5, who says, where do birds go to have a drink? A crowbar. I'm not leaving yet. Good.
Yeah, I just got a mouse pointer stuck in the middle of the screen now.
Last job of the day is always the worst. Sorry about that.
I don't know why.
That is very strange.
We're all just going to have to live with it. Because I blame having to alt tab out of the game.
Oh, sure.
You know what? I might just quit out of the game and start it again, and we'll see if that helps.
Do it. Yes, everyone should be very jealous of Yahtzee for getting to pet my cat. It is a treat reserved for a very few.
He's a sweetheart.
It's wild to see ZP and Jack playing something I worked on. Josh Leap, did you work on
Devs in
My
chat.
Friendly Neighborhood?
Devs in chat. Everybody
Devs
run.
In chat?
Yes, let's talk about how much we love this game.
Josh Leap, which one did you work on?
Which bit?
I'm Googling your name right now.
Hang on, I had to alt-tab out again to move the chat around. So this time I'll just start the game and do no alt-tabbing flappery. And maybe this time the mouse pointer will go away.
I'm searching through your social media posts right now, Josh Leap. Oh, that game looks fun. You're making lots of things. I'm in the credits for tech art on My Friendly Neighborhood. Oh, there you go. Devs in chat, everyone be on your best behavior.
Tech art?
Tech art. That's what Josh Leap says. Whether it's true or not, we'll never know. Okay.
Last job of the day. The mouse pointer gone now, besides the in-game one?
Yes, I no longer see the white mouse pointer.
Well, that's a relief, because I could still see the little turny circle white.
Yeah, I see that. Oh my god, are we going to have the little turny circle in the center now? What?
Oh god.
You know what? That's kind of better. That's just like an aiming reticle.
Well, this game sort of deliberately doesn't have a targeting reticle to make the gun combat slightly trickier.
How funny. What a weird quirk.
I think it's windowed mode. Hang on.
Sure.
We'll just full screen it.
There
How's
go.
That? Is that better?
There you go. Now we can't see it.
Okay.
Ooh.
Just have to put the chat in a smaller window for now.
I'll do my best to keep up on it. What kind of cat is it? Biscuit is a long-haired Siberian.
Ooh. Toffee's a short-haired Chihuahua mix. Maybe they'd be friends.
Probably. Like, Biscuit's pretty chill. Biscuit is pretty chill, except for when sleeping where I want him to sleep.
Raise the curtain. Bring up the lights. The neighborhood is coming to town.
Hello. I'm here to disconnect the antenna.
Yeah, we'll see if this works.
Television's heartbeat has returned. A spirit of cheer brightens every
Hi, Biscuit.
Cry goes round the kindergarten class. The neighborhood. The neighborhood.
Okay. Great. There you go.
I'm here to disconnect.
That's the biscuit you get.
I am Ricky the Sock. Your television will never be the
That's
same.
That's all the biscuit you get.
Well, if we could return to the matter of the video games that we...
Oh, right. That's right.
That we are correspondents for. Yes. So My Friendly Neighborhood, you're a dude, a maintenance dude, who's come to a studio that used to put on like a Sesame Street-style show. And all the puppets have come to life and they're going to try to kill us.
Okay. Barfing up credential cards already. That's great.
There you go.
We like that. We enjoy
Good.
That.
Okay, then. again?
Nothing they ever explain why the puppets have come to life. They just are. It's like, that's just how they made the show. It's like Roger Rabbit.
Yeah, they just are. I like that. SVS Guru 2000, thanks for the €5, who says the only correct answer to what kind of cat is its color. I'm sorry, Biscuit is a very fancy cat. I will give you his full details. And Taco Bell, oh, go ahead.
Didn't he used to be a show cat?
Yes, one second place in a local cat show.
Oh, does he have a did he have a show name?
His official title, because he is a purebred long-haired Siberian. So his official name is Sir. Oh God, it's Sir Wind Drifter. Oh, and I'm gonna forget it.
Why do people do this to cats?
Right. It's like, Sir Gabriel Wind Drifter of Heaven Sent.
Oh, fuck.
That is his full name. Yes.
That's like the name of the D&D character of the dude who gets into it too much.
Yes. That's right. I'm an Oath of Light paladin, Sir Gabriel Wind Drifter of Heaven Sent. And like the way you have to name pure breeds is like, it's like Gabriel is his name. Wind Drifter is his father's name.
What would happen if you just showed up to the cat show with and you said, yeah, this is my cat. It's called Bob. But it's just the most beautiful cat they've ever seen. What would they do?
You would, in order to be selected for shows, you need proper paperwork. And proper paperwork means that you need proper naming. I'm sorry.
Okay, but what happens if you don't, though?
Then you can't get into the cat show, I'm sorry.
What happens if you fill out all the paperwork perfectly well, but it's just that the cat's name is Bob?
Like Bob of Bob?
No, just Bob.
It can't be. It can't be because it has to be the cat's name, the lineage name, and the breeder name. Sir Gabriel Windrifter of Heaven Sent. Gabriel is his name. Wind Drifter is the father's name, because you name after the stud, and Heaven Sent is the breeder's name.
Couldn't you just call it 1, 2 of 3?
That would be great. That would be great.
So it's not possible to enter a cat show if it's just a new cat that just hasn't. Whose previous lineage didn't have any, you know, clout?
Probably not. Like the way that like cat and dog shows work is totally fucked. Like if we're talking about like just like fancy like look at me shows, not like agility shows, because you choose the best cat based off of breed standards. It's so fucked.
That's pretty fucked.
That's not
child beauty pageant fucked, but fucked on in the same sort of way.
Oh, absolutely. So yeah, like that's why even really ugly dogs can win dog shows, because they perfectly align to breed standards.
Yeah, I've heard that Toffee would be thrown out of a Chihuahua competition because he's a deer head Chihuahua, and they just don't allow those. It's got to be Applehead, the ones that can barely breathe. Those are the only Chihuahuas that count, I'm afraid.
Yeah.
It's okay, Toffee. I think you're special.
So yeah, we had met with this breeder because Biscuit is hypoallergenic, and we were looking for a hypoallergenic cat. And so we were kind of on a waiting list for when Biscuit, who was a stud, produced some kittens. And then we got a call saying, hey, actually... he hasn't produced anything for a while, and we're ready to retire him. Do you just want a cat? And we were like, hell yeah, we'll just take a cat. And so we are Biscuit's retirement package.
I see.
Which is great.
Well, no wonder Biscuit always seems so tired.
He spent his early years boning. Taco Bell combo number 6. Thank you for being an early access member for 2 months. We appreciate that support. It says, y'all the best, breasts and beer.
Those games go kind of like a Silent Hill 4 mechanic, where the monsters all come back to life after you leave the room and come back. But if you can find some duct tape, then you can restrain specific enemies so they never come back.
I like that. But not every enemy.
No. Just the one, this one specific instance of the enemy that appears in this room can be taped up so you never have to deal with it again.
Gotcha. Gotcha.
And, I guess I'll just, since we just saved, I'll demonstrate how the enemy attacks you.
Okay, I'm ready.
They hug you, and you push them away because you're a grumpy old man, and you fall over.
That's it.
Yeah, that's the horror. And you can only live through like four of these. We are a very fragile man.
That the kind of emotional resonance that happens when a puppet hugs you is overwhelming. I'll be honest. So,
yeah,
I get
especially
it.
When they never stop yelling. It's a little alarming, I suppose.
100%. 100%. SVS Guru 2000, thanks for the €2, who says, I guarantee the cat itself chose the name. Probably. And Lampy, thanks for the £5 donation, who says, did you get a family tree for Biscuit Jack? When we got a purebred dog, they came with a full family tree. Yes, we have all of Biscuit's paperwork, including his second place award at a local cat show.
Yeah, my wife's parents' dog was a purebred, like Golden Lab. Apparently they got a family tree for it, and half the dogs on it were the same dog.
Yes. Yes, it's a very real problem.
Yeah,
with disreputable and even some reputable breeders that inbreeding turns into a really big problem. My mom's favorite kind of dogs are German Shepherds, and she got a couple German Shepherds. Like we would go to visit, like when she needed a new dog. That's a very off-putting statement. When she wanted a new dog, she went to these breeders, and we went there, and we saw that the stud was like circling in the backyard and like digging at this hole, and there's one area of grass that was just worn raw, and the breeder was like, oh yeah, I saw a squirrel over there 8 years ago, hasn't given up on it, and we all thought it was cute, and then you know she ended up getting a dog from this breeder, and the dog was absolutely the dumbest dog you would ever meet. No training could help this dog. Just an idiot.
Oh,
and
yeah,
she was like, I'm pretty sure this is a inbred dog that's just an idiot.
That describes my wife's parents' dog pretty much. Very, very thick dog. The kind of dog that will just like sit in the corner eating polystyrene, never registering what it tastes like or what it's doing to their body.
Right. Right. Just dummy dogs. So, yes, you know, one, you know, you don't need a purebred dog. There's plenty of good dogs out there. Two,
yes.
If you're going to go purebred, just look into it. Look into it a little bit.
Yeah, we've only ever gotten adopted shelter dogs. What was that? Mm-hmm. Adopted shelter dogs need love.
Absolutely. Plenty of them out there.
We got Toffee during the COVID pandemic, and he was literally the only dog in the shelter available for adoption because they were all snapped up. Everyone wanted a dog to get through the lonely times.
Yep. Pretty normal. Pretty normal.
Now we have a gun that shoots letters at things.
Oh my god, that's great. That's great. That's hilarious. I love that, actually.
You sound like you're being sarcastic.
It does. It does because I'm trying to hold on to a question from chat, but I think the thing I love about it is the fact that, like, you're... Like, the bullets are like letters written on paper, but you shoot actual three-dimensional letters.
Yeah. Another thing
that's very, very fun.
Really explain much.
You don't need to. It's fun. Brought to you by the letter H. That's great.
Bloody puppets.
Larry Fix says, Jack, what game systems do you use in Foundry VTT? PF2E? Yes. So obviously we use D&D 5th edition for all Adventurers Nigh stuff, and that's what I use for my D&D home games as well.
With a couple of source book add-ons here and there, like Dabarella's War Chef class.
Of course, but like the... This is going to sound like an ad. I swear it's not. The neat thing about Foundry is you can add all of that stuff later. Is we've been able to pull in weird homebrew shit and have it work within the game system of Foundry.
Wow, that sounds great, Jack. Do you remember when we had to do all these during the shoot?
All the ad reads. Oh, I'm editing them now. Yes, I remember them all very, very well.
Oh, what fun we had.
Well, you know, it paid for the thing, and we're pretty happy about that. I've been playing a little bit of Pathfinder 2E with some internet friends, and so I've been running the Pathfinder module for Foundry is beautiful. Whoever made the Pathfinder stuff for Foundry is on top of their shit. It is so easy to play and learn the game and know like what it is you are doing with all of the Pathfinder stuff. It's significantly easier than whoever wrote the D&D 5e module.
I'd hate to be on top of my shit. It would make my trousers very dirty.
That's why you get the high waters. So I've been playing that. I've been messing around with Monster of the Week. They have a Monster of the Week system in there because I want to learn that game. And I've been messing around a little bit with the Blades in the Dark module as well.
Mm.
Blades in the Dark is the heist game. Is the heist game in which you can Ocean's 11. Well, actually, I slipped something underneath the doormat. Roll to see if you actually did.
Well, which is, that's intriguing.
Yes, it sounds like an incredibly fun game. So I've been trying to learn that system as well. It's taped shut.
You know, I just remembered I got through this whole game. I don't think I ever opened this. I kept going back to it.
Do you get a knife at any point?
No, all you get is this wrench for melee combat.
Weird.
Well, it can't have been that important because I got the best ending.
Oh. Jack, does Biscuit allow you to manhandle him? Biscuit allows literally anyone to manhandle
him. Yeah, he's a pretty chill cat.
Yeah, people just come in and pick him up, man. Absolutely. Captain President, thanks for the $5 American, says, why does the gun not hold 26 ammo? Yahtzee.
One for each letter of the alphabet, you mean?
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe, I guess the people who made this game aren't as clever as you.
The Escapist needs to make a video to explain these systems like 5e and Pathfinder for chumps like me. No, it's far too complicated, George Lucas. I've joked many times... the how to play part of the player's guide for Dungeons and Dragons is on page 174 of the player's guide. There are 174 pages before you get to how to play. Fucking nuts.
Character building, is it?
Yes. Point? Yeah, class, race, yeah. And some stuff like that. Which is very fair. Obviously, that's an important part of the game. Pathfinder is even more difficult to play from a DM perspective, I believe. Lampy, I have played Lexicon. Actually, Jesse has been DMing a Lexicon game for myself and some other people, and I've been enjoying it quite a bit. Lexicon is the tabletop role-playing game that our very own Jesse Galena has authored.
Huh. I didn't know he'd authored a game style.
Yeah, it's very interesting. It's a system in which all of the pluses and minuses that you add to your dice rolls are based off of your character motivation and I actually have it in front of me. Is based off of your character motivations, traits, and skills. So all of your superpowers are based off of your motivations. And you can say like, oh, my motivation is I want revenge, right? My sister was murdered or something. And you say this knight is a bodyguard for the person who murdered my sister, so I'm going to use my motivation. That gives you a +1 to your roll.
Oh, I see.
That sort of thing. It's very interesting.
It's a game for bullshitting the DM.
Yes. Well, in hopes of adding to your role play above mechanics.
So. I see.
Very, very, very interesting. It's very fun to play. One, in general, because I DM a lot, so it's very fun to play in general. But also, it's a very interesting role-playing system.
Hmm.
And we haven't even scratched the surface of how many role-playing systems there are in the world.
Ooh, it's a bird.
Oh, my God.
A very large bird. How else would one say that, do you think?
Let's see here. Gargantuan fowl?
Ginormous avian.
Ooh. A bulbous feathered creature.
Bulbous? I don't know what you think bulbous means.
I ran out of synonyms, so I went with bulbous.
Large, giant. Gigantic, humongous.
Colossal.
It's colossal. Off-puttingly big.
Uncomfortable.
Yeah. Distressingly large.
Ooh, there we go. Distressingly. Aiden, thanks for the $10 Australian, who says, ever try D&D in Warhammer 40K? Try Only War. Its gimmick is you are an Imperial Guardsman, the average Joe, but you play with an assistant, i.e. medic, plus nurse, heavy weapons guy, plus ammo assistant.
Okay, I am never going to play that.
Not only am I never going to play that, the things you wrote make no sense to me. I'm sorry. I know nothing of Warhammer 40K.
I only play D&D and that for like 8 sessions every 6 months.
But you're getting very good at it.
That's gratifying to hear you say. I finally figured out how stealth attack works for season 3. I made great use of that.
You've always been good at the role-playing aspect of it, you know, obviously because of your entertainment background.
My secret is that I'm secretly a hateful, self-hating, devious prick.
There you go. But yes, during season 3, all of you new players were actually using your mechanics during actual gameplay situations, which was incredible to see. Incredible to see.
Get away from me. See, it's hard to describe this game as horror because...
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's not scary because nothing startles you. Like, you walk into a room and the monsters are all just standing there. And they're always, like, yelling every thought that crosses their mind. So they can never take you by surprise.
Right. Is it only horror in the pitch? Like, it wants you to think, it wants you to be in the mindset of a horror game, even though it is very much not a horror game.
I suppose. I suppose it's like horror on a sort of goosebumps level. Maybe sub goosebumps.
Sure.
It's definitely sort of satirical.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely not taking itself seriously.
Sure. Like, I remember seeing the trailer for this and getting very hard, don't hug me, I'm scared vibes.
Yeah, it's not that. It's not It's this, but it's not also trying to be disturbing.
Sure.
It's just you're in a studio full of very earnest puppets that want to hug you.
Right.
And you don't want to be hugged because you're a surly old man with a bad back. And that's the horror, that they might hug you to death.
Yeah, and there's no like existential level to it. Oh my god, that legally distinct bird that is large is coming to get you.
I'm not sure it can hurt you. I don't think it ever actually hurt me when I was playing this game.
Yeah.
Although I didn't give it much chance to I didn't give it much testing because, you know, I have so little health.
Sure. Matt Bronzel, new episodes of Adventures Night come out every other week. And so last week, Saturday, episode 2 came out for everyone. This week, Saturday, episode 3 will come out for early access users. And then next week, episode 3 will come out for everyone.
There you go.
So every other week, you get them a week early if you are an early access member. Like many, many things over at The Escapist, watch stuff early if you give us money. Because the money means that we can make things.
Yes, that's nice.
Making it is. Things. We are exchanging, you know, the goods or services that we are exchanging for money are content.
Yes, our precious time.
Yes. Hopefully our entertainment. That is what you are paying for. That is our service, our goods and our service. Speaking of early access, StuFu92, welcome to early access. We appreciate that support. Oh, and Personal Miner 123 also joined early access. This is how you do it. This is how we make the stuff. We appreciate that.
Yay.
Yeah, you're nice doing it, everybody.
Hey, you can all go and watch the Baldur's Gate 3 review when we're done jabbering.
Ooh.
Ah, bugger.
How many times, as a little teaser, how many times did you mention the penises?
Well, if that's your bag, you might be more interested in this week's extra punctuation that's going out for members. Which is on the subject of the horniness of Baldur's Gate 3 and how justified it all is in the long run.
Horniness and how justified it is. All right, very interesting.
Oh, bugger, I got molested to death.
You got horny to death?
Gotta watch those Jim Henson puppets. They've picked up a few things. Wasn't there a Muppet special called Sex and Violence?
Oh, God, I really hope not.
Because Jim Henson's big thing was that he very deliberately wanted Sesame Street to be for the kids and the Muppets to be have a broader range of entertainment. Mm. So he was trying to make like adult comedy stuff with them as well.
Ugh. I don't like that. Because at the end of the day, they're still puppets.
Well, they were in Meet the Feebles as well.
Yeah, that's why I don't like it. Aiden, thanks.
Early Peter Jackson film.
That's right.
Do not rent it for your kids.
Oh, God, don't rent it for you. It's weird.
It's weird in that very characteristic early Peter Jackson way. He was... I wonder how he ever landed the Lord of the Rings gig, to be honest.
Well, they saw Dead Alive, and they said, hey, when your main character straps a lawnmower to their chest in order to liquefy 100 zombies, you'll get Tolkien.
And that's absolutely the least of it in that film.
Oh, God. Dead Alive's great. Dead Alive is fucking great.
Dead or Alive is comparatively mainstream if you also watch Meet the Feebles.
Yes. Very true.
There is absolutely no comparison. It's just extraordinary, like mouth-droppingly awful. not in like a poor quality way.
Right. Okay, let's see here. Oh no, these are awards. Where are just all of your movies?
He did The Frighteners, right. Didn't he?
As a director, he did Bad Taste.
Yeah, that was his first movie, which was
he did Meet the Feebles.
Weird and super gory.
This is insane. So yeah, he did Bad Taste, Meet the Feebles, Brain Dead, which we know is Dead Alive.
Yeah.
Heavenly Creatures. And then The Frighteners.
Yeah, that's the one I just mentioned. That was the Michael J. Fox movie.
Yep.
That's more of sort of a family fun adventure thing.
A little bit, but with ghosts.
Yeah, and isn't Jeffrey Combs in that?
Possibly. I know, oh God, the bad guy in that is one of the creepiest bad guys ever. I want to say it's a Busey. Jake Busey.
Yeah, I think Jake Busey was the baddie, and Jeffrey Combs plays like a weirdo FBI agent, I think.
Oh, sure. But yeah, basically he went from The Frighteners to The Lord of the Rings.
Well, he was a huge Lord of the Rings fan. Maybe his like passion came across at the interview stage.
Possibly. And like maybe with The Frighteners, he proved to the Weinsteins that he could like play ball as far as like a mid-size studio is concerned. You know, perhaps they had notes and he took them very well.
Yeah. At the end of the day, sometimes like the dude who just shows up on time and does the job is the dude you want. The dude who gets the job because he's just reliable.
Abso-fucking-lutely. Like, why do you think... who's the guy that made the Flash movie? Is Andy Muschietti is getting his own Batman movie.
I guess he shows up really on time.
well, because he finished. Like, he finished the Flash movie that no one else could finish. This damn thing has been in production for, you know, years and years and years, and he crossed the finish line with it. It was not a good movie, but the man crossed the finish line with it, and so Warner Brothers says, you did it, you finished our movie, you get to now make a movie that you want to make. Which is a huge deal.
You scratch my back, etc.
Etc. Exactly. So, yes. Sometimes you just got to get it done. Let's see here. Aiden, thanks for the $5 Australian, says, could you enhance the puppet dialogue if they sounded like they were in a jolly drunk rant?
You mean they don't already sound like that?
And Fungus Finder, thanks for the $2 American, who says, is it so bad to want to boff a squid alien? Rude. No, just not my thing. It's fine. And Duel Me, 123, welcome to Early Access. We appreciate that support. Another Batman origin after The Batman 2. Yes, I believe he's making a Batman the Brave and the Bold movie, which will be separate from the Batman movies, which will be separate from the Nolan Batman movies, which are separate from the 89 Batman movies.
Is there such thing as too many Batmans?
Yes, there is. There's significantly too many things. But Brave and the Bold Batman is a fun Batman.
Okay. So I mean, on a sliding scale from Adam West on one end and Frank Miller on the other, where are we?
We are closer to... We're not... I mean, no one can be as far as Adam West, but we are much closer to the Adam West side of things.
Okay.
So...
Does he have drawn-on eyebrows on his mask?
No, he does not. I believe the Brave and Bold cartoon was based off of a series of comics called The Brave and the Bold, and they all have a much, you know, like, I don't want to say a light tone, but they embrace the absurdity of Batman in a very fun way.
Which specific absurdity are we talking about here? Because there's a few.
Well, the general absurdity of Batman in general, of someone who goes out and punches people with superpowers and costumes and comic books, and it embraces that absurdity, and it has a grounded reality, but it also kind of does a little side look to the viewer to say, we know this is silly and we're okay with it. As that t-shirt just pointed out so precisely, it's camp.
Okay.
Which is very fun. That's a Batman that I'm fun, that I think is fun. Dylan Fletcher, thanks for the $4.99 American. Sorry, there's no words with it. If you wanted to type words, I'll keep an eye out for you, Dylan Fletcher. But we appreciate your money.
Sure do.
And Philip Common, welcome to Early Access. That support. This is how we're doing it. The Brave and the Bold I'm seeing in chat is a dedicated crossover comic book. So that's where they get to have a little fun, which is very neat.
It's no one's specific title.
Correct.
Gotcha.
Snake in the Garden says, Jack, what game are you, what game TV show are you playing, watching in your free time at the moment? I'm playing a crap ton of Team Fortress 2 now that the servers are back alive.
Yeah, I noticed that on Steam. You were in Team Fortress 2 a lot.
Yeah, it's great. It's fucking great still. And now that other people are playing it again, it's a damn good time.
Well, it does help.
With a multiplayer game, yes, you need other people. A lot more bots and cheating than I remember.
Someone's always got to ruin it for everyone else.
Right. I'm also playing a delightful little like SNES throwback platformer called Tiny Thor.
Oh, I know that one. Yeah, I played that one for a bit.
Yeah. It's very delightful. I'm like 6 hours in right now and kind of done. The game tells me I'm about 60% through, and I don't know if that means like with the story or with like all the side bits, but like I'm kind of ready to call it. But
yeah,
very fun for what it is.
Play till you finish the game or until you know your opinion isn't going to change. That's my motto.
Yes, and like right now we're getting to Tiny Thor is a, I guess it's a precision platformer kind of like base level, and you use Thor's little tiny hammer kind of in the platforming and in like taking care of enemies during the platforming.
Yeah,
and it does an okay job. Like the platforming puzzles are very interesting, though the character movement is a little floatier than you would like in something that's a precision platformer.
Right.
Overall, I still think it's very good. I still think it's a good game. It might not be good enough for me to finish it.
Fair enough.
Dun, dun, dun,
dun. I played it for like an hour and got bored. So yeah.
Mm-hmm. Very understandable. Very, very understandable. Yes, I'm very mad that I was not invited to the Team Fortress 2 game night. What are you going to do? I told Nick we need another one because I enjoy Team Fortress 2. Kamja Ninja, thanks for the $5 America, who says, y'all into dad games and speedruns? Then may I introduce the daddest of speedrunners, MSXL Esports. They're real and they're serious and they're intense.
Yeah, I've heard of that.
I think People Make Games just did a little thing on MSXL Esports, right?
This is a thing.
It's a thing.
Is it just like who can scroll to the bottom the fastest or something?
No. It is like they put like absurd business problems in front of you And the real trick of it is making formulas to automate procedures, because like they give you like a ton of seemingly disparate information, and then they ask you to make like charts and graphs and business proposals like based off of these off of this numbers, and you only have like 5 hours to do it. And so it's all about like knowing the automation processes of Excel. It looks hilarious and wonderful.
What if other things besides video games become the subject of speedrunning? Like validating data, like just somebody's job.
Yes.
Who in the world holds the world record for operating a McDonald's cheeseburger making machine? Who can make McDonald's cheeseburgers the fastest?
Right? I think that's really fun.
Once we all have Google glasses or like face implants, so we've got like integrated HUDs in daily life.
Yeah.
People are going to start streaming their daily lives, and that's going to be a thing. Speed running, basic job tasks, and chores around the house.
Speed running my commute to work.
And our civilization will suddenly magically become much more efficient and advanced just because of that. We're going to speed run inventing flying cars. And then we become a technological utopia, all thanks to speed running.
Speed running tying my shoes. New any percent world record. Like any percent means like it just needs to be a knot. It doesn't need to be the standard bunny ear knot, any knot. And that's any percent. But yeah, I want to say that the hold on, let me see if I can find that, because I can say I want to say, or I can look it up on the internet. People make games.
The
I think
internet,
it's
you say?
Games.
I've heard of that.
Yes. There it is. Yes. You've heard of the internet?
I've heard it's the next big thing.
Wonderful. Yes. The lovely people over at People Make Games made a little video about entering a Excel esports competition and getting their asses handed to them. I just put it into the chat right there. It is a lovely little little video all about the absurdity of Excel esports.
I just had the most vilest thought I've had all week.
All right, I'm ready.
I'm just imagining a doctor running into a pregnancy ward saying, "Good news, we've got a new being alive speed run."
Oh! Lunch is my favorite meal of the day. I only think that most of this is how lunch. It technically took a breath outside, so that counts. That's very dark. That's very dark. We laugh because it's dark. Because yes, there's darkness in the world and we laugh at it. Oh,
and
boy.
We could both think back to the moments when our own children were born and be grateful we're never going to have to go through that again.
Oh, yeah. Oh, man. It's, you know, it's... I guess we won't delve on that for too long. But, yeah. Oh, boy. Right, Henry? Who busting out the new dead baby jokes here in 2023.
Hey.
Cutting edge comedy.
There's always new ones.
There's always new ones. Yeah, there's probably there's a joke in there. And in any case, yes, speed running mundane activities. As someone who dabbles in Microsoft Excel, or you know, like I use Google Sheets, right? Because
I use Google Sheets on my bottom.
Like, who wants to pay for Excel? So I have several, like, graphs and charts for kind of daily stuff. You know, very famously, I have my T-shirt chart for the shirts that I wear whenever I appear on Red Letter Media. That helps me keep track of what I wear, make sure I don't wear the same thing twice. I have a few charts for, you know, various stuff around my life, and I really like the automation aspects of Excel or Google Sheets.
So it's interesting you have that attitude to shirts. because I just wear black button-downs every day in the hopes that people will think I only have one.
Ooh.
And now I just got a wardrobe full of identical outfits like Homer Simpson.
I think that's, you know, that's one way to handle it. Obviously, like, I don't stress about it in my daily life. I think of it more, like, for Red Letter Media videos, I think of it more like a wardrobe department, right? Where it's like, oh, you know, we want to make sure that the wardrobe that you're wearing is appropriate. And, you know, I think, like, Jay definitely takes that attitude where he's like, I'm just going to wear a plain shirt so I don't have to worry about it. But for me, it's like I like graphic tees. I like that kind of stuff. And I don't want to run into a situation where someone watches a video and then clicks on another random video and I'm wearing the same shirt. Ugh. I don't know why that's important to me, Yahtzee, but it is.
Oh, enough.
So in any case, the automation aspects of something like Excel is amazing and phenomenal. And watch this little short when you have time. It's great. Lampy, thanks for the £5, who says, do they call people who use Google Sheets casual gamers? Yeah, if you're not using Excel, then you're casual.
Fucking casuals.
Fucking casual. Do I own a TTRPG table? No. No, I just have a regular table.
It would be weird to have a special dedicated one of those.
They exist. Huge market.
You get tables to just have like a permanent Scrabble board in them.
Yeah. No, there's a huge market for them. You know, not only like so when I play my home game, I just have like a monitor that I put facing up on the table so that everyone can see the map. And then they like point to it like, oh, my character goes here, my character goes here, that sort of thing.
Hmm.
But there are some RPG tables that have a monitor built in, that have special software for placing your maps in them, that have like dedicated dice rolling areas, cup holders, areas to hold your player sheets. Like it gets nuts and expensive very fast.
I'll bet.
Because, you know, hobbies be expensive. Paul, thanks for the $2 American, says, hey, Yachts, how do you about lack of quick saving in D&D?
Well, I certainly couldn't get through Baldur's Gate 3 without that.
It doesn't need some quick saves?
It doesn't auto save much.
Oh.
So you gotta be ready on the save scum front, or you might lose a lot of progress.
Oh, sure. That's old school, then. I bet a lot of newer gamers are probably struggling with that.
I just gave the large avian her spectacles back. Maybe we can be friends.
Aww. There you go. Large avian spectacles back. There you go. Do-do-do-do-do. Microsoft. I have a chess table. Oh yeah, like there's if you're really into it, and like I've talked about getting a special table, like a special. That's a good girl. Oh, now you can be friends with Large Bird.
Yeah, like this is the double twist of this game. You run into these big scary puppet monsters, but there's for all the like the major villain monsters, you can find a way to make friends with them.
That's adorable. That's great. Like I've talked to my wife about getting a gaming table because we play a lot of board games. We have a lot of game nights, a lot of people over to play board games. And so like having tables with doodads and whatnot, but they're just ungodly expensive.
Mm.
So we just have a big flat table.
Yeah. Whatever does the job, right?
Right. And so, you know, we just got a cheap flat table and it's like, well, this is what we got. This is how we're going to do it. But I've seen a couple of very fun gaming tables, and maybe if there's ever a good price or if they want to sponsor Adventurers 9, give me a table. There we go.
Always be hustling.
Hell yes. SVS Guru 2000, thanks for the €2, who said Techmoan recently reviewed an automatic chessboard.
Couldn't you just play computer chess or something?
You could, yeah.
What's your opinion on limited saves, by the way?
Limited saves, like as in how far you can go back in a save?
No, I mean the Resident Evil style where you need to find a special inventory item to save, and there's a limited number of them. See, this game does that, and also there's a heal machine that also takes the same tokens. So if you want to heal and save, you got to use up two tokens that you can't get back.
I love the idea of that. I think that does an amazing job of upping the tension, and in a game that's trying to create tension, that's a great way to do it. Because I haven't played the game, how frustrating is it from your perspective?
Well, I guess not so frustrating. It felt like something worth pointing out in the review.
Sure.
I managed to get through the game easily enough. Because it's fairly easy to just avoid combat.
Like, right.
So just go inside a door. And there's no shortage of ammo.
You know,
I think the chat is demanding that I play some Guess the Game.
Oh, man. I saw that. Was that on last week's stream or the stream before? I have been playing that every single day.
I know. It's addictive.
It's so good. It's so flippin' good.
It's so nice to find something that actually makes use of the useless information I spent the last 16 years gathering as a professional game player.
Oh, so good. And, well, because here's the thing that always bothered me about Wordle, is if you ever got the Wordle in one, it was just a guess.
Yeah.
You know, like where you didn't feel good about getting it in one or even two, where you're like, I'm just guessing. You got Wordle in three, like if you could deduce the word, then it felt like you were doing something. But with Guess the Game, if you can get it, like I forget, there was one, you know, you start going back. There was one that was just very clearly, you know, a Super Nintendo game that I absolutely knew what it was. And it's like, that's my first guess. Got it in one because I'm just that smart.
Yes. It always feels very gratifying to get it in one.
Ooh, Guess the Game is so great.
Yeah, I'm going to bring up some Guess the Game. Oh, I already did today. So the answer's going to be on screen. Hang on.
Oh, okay.
Let me get that off screen. Have you done today's?
I believe I did today's. Oh yeah, I did do today's. It was tricky.
Yeah, I guessed basically every game in that franchise up until I guessed the one it actually was.
That's where it gets tricky, is with all the sequels and whatnot. Yeah.
I assumed someone saying it'd be nice if you had like a prequel or a sequel if the game gave you a little hint to that effect.
Ooh,
like just said, ooh, you're pretty warm.
Lampy with 2 pounds says, why not try the map one Jack found instead? I don't know if Yahtzee knows any of those maps as well as I do.
I think this is something Frost told me about. It was like GeoGuessr, but in video games.
Yes.
And you were really good at the Elden Ring one.
I am absurdly good at the Elden Ring one, yes. And they also have a Breath of the Wild one, and I think they have a GTA one as well.
I don't think I'd be as good at any of those. I might do pretty well on the Zelda Wind Waker one if they got one.
Ooh, right.
Oh, that's Silent Hill 2, isn't it?
Ooh. I mean, obviously some sort of horror, right? Right off the bat.
Could even be Silent Hill 1, looking at the textures.
Could be. Yeah, definitely older, definitely some sort of horror, but I mean, that it could be anything. What are you going with? Silent Hill 1?
Oh, in one. Look at that.
In one. Nailed it.
Would have been obvious from number 4, I think.
Beautiful.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, so you just go at random.
Yeah. That's Celeste?
100%.
100% Celeste?
100% Celeste. Look at that.
I hate this drop down. Every time I play this game, I vent to someone about this drop down.
Yes.
Why did Celeste not be the first thing, considering Celeste is the thing that I literally typed?
Yeah, and if you deleted some of those letters, Celeste would pop up there. Yeah. Beautiful. Beautiful guess.
Okay. Huh.
Ooh.
I'm getting Luigi's Mansion vibes.
Ooh.
Maybe Luigi's Mansion 2, but it might be a bit high res for that. Because Luigi's Mansion 2 is on the 3DS.
Is it Ori?
I don't think it's Ori. Ori doesn't have buildings.
Oh, sure. You're right. That's just in the forest. This looks like the cover to Luigi's Mansion, but do they ever show covers, or is it just game screen?
No, they never do covers. I thought it looked like the cover of Maniac Mansion for a second.
Yeah.
Some people in the chat are suggesting Medieval, and I'm willing to go along with that. Oh, nope, it wasn't that. Oh.
What's that Metacritic score?
85.
Okay, so a highly rated game.
Well, I'd say 85. Ship. 85 is more of a lukewarm reception in my experience.
Is this a point and click?
I don't think so.
You know, like that's a path that theoretically you could click on. The rocket ship? You know, like why the rocket ship? Yeah, there's a cat there, sure. Yeah. This is just rando guess. You almost want to say something like Maniac Mansion.
I don't think it's Maniac Mansion. I'm going to go on a huge limb here.
Okay. Peggle? What?
Oh, what do you know?
What? Wait a minute.
Well, it's just something about the fact that there was a stationary cat in the background made me think of the spooky levels from Peggle.
Cycle through more of them. Now I'm very curious. Okay.
Yep.
I think I would have gotten it by four. Four, I would have gotten Peggle, but boy.
I'm not cheating, Dr. Zebra. I'm genuinely this pathetic. and I've had this one before. This is the one that's where the thing where you only platform up and it's like getting over it from Bennett Foddy, but not.
Oh, the 3D one? Is that like, it's called like Get Up or what is it? What is that called?
I think it's called Only Up.
Oh, I think that's it.
Oh, this wasn't it. Because I have had Only Up before on this, but this is something else, apparently. Huh. Actually, I think I've had this one before as well, so I'll probably get it if I have to pick any more. But
what's the score?
80%.
80%. Like with the broken and still buildings, it almost makes me think of like a BioShock Infinite.
Oh, everyone in chats is saying it's Valorant.
Oh.
There you go.
Well, don't go to chat. This is you have to not look at chat for this game.
Well, sorry. But I just looked at the rest of the screenshots, and I would not have gotten it.
No,
this is a multiplayer-focused game, and that's not my shtick.
I also would not have gotten that one.
Okay. Well, they're not making it easy with this one.
That's great. What the fuck is that?
It's like one of those itch.io horror games, you know?
Right? Or
like a PS1 game.
Or possibly one of those like, you know, side scroll like puzzle light atmosphere focused.
Yeah.
Or like you said, like a 3D PS1 demake.
Yeah.
This is The Back Rooms, right?
I don't know. I never played The Back Rooms.
I don't even know if that's a game.
Nope.
Oh, there you go.
I think I might skip the first. That's not telling as much at all.
Agreed.
Ah. Metacritic score too old and doesn't make sense.
Metacritic score too old and doesn't make sense. What the fuck is this game?
What are you on about? Guess the game.
You cannot look at chat for this. This one we have to figure out for ourselves.
It looks like maybe SimCopter, but I know it's not SimCopter because I've seen SimCopter on this before, and it wasn't this. Let's look at like is a it, city building thing, maybe?
Or is it Roblox?
Roblox isn't too old, surely.
Roblox is a very old game, and it would make sense with the doesn't make sense thing because, you know, it's a million games in one, right? Like, Roblox isn't a game.
Well, I've got any other guesses, but I don't think it's Roblox. No, it isn't.
What?
Okay, we've got a sort of first-person aiming reticle going on there.
Okay. This is fascinating. Original platform PC.
Makes me think of one of those Earth Defense Force games.
But it's and it's old. It's too old.
Too old.
And doesn't make sense. Whenever we find this out, I'm going to Metacritic and I'm gonna see what the score is.
I'm gonna try Virtua Cop.
Ooh, okay.
Oh, that's Gary's mod. That's the Gary's mod gun.
Oh, okay.
Oh, that's hardly fair.
That's not necessarily a game.
No.
I guess neither is Roblox.
How are you supposed to get Gary's mod from that first one? That's bullshit, guess the game.
And I guess that makes sense why it doesn't make sense. Hold on. I'm going to go to Metacritic, and I want to see, like, what they say about Gary's mod.
Okay, I'll tackle this new one.
Okay.
Okay, we got some bright primaries, some kind of fantasy tree arrangement.
Oh, excuse you.
Something very dark. My head's leaning in a Fable 2 sort of area, although maybe not.
Sure. Very difficult to discern.
I don't think it's Turok chat because you can see more than 6 feet in front of you.
Right.
Nope.
Yeah. No, this almost looks like World of Warcrafty, but I don't think we would have this perspective.
No, okay, I think it's a chest.
Yeah, that looks like a treasure chest. Yeah, yeah.
With a... What do we want to say? Like a early 2000s-y sort of graphical style?
Yeah, yeah. Late 90s, early 2000s. So possibly a 3D game. I'm assuming this is a PC game. I'm assuming, yeah. Right now, it could be anything. It doesn't. That is not like a Zelda chest. You know, like that's you know, you see a chest in the woods, you go, oh, Zelda. Definitely not a Zelda chest.
Well, let me just pluck a title out of the air. Just to have something to guess. Okay, it wasn't Dark Cloud.
Okay.
Metacritic score 81%.
81%?
Okay, it's looking more 360 era now.
We have... Are those crystal monsters? Or just crystals in general?
Well, there's definitely crystals in the background. I don't know if there's also a monster there.
81. That's a tough Metacritic score, yeah.
Yeah, so it wasn't panned, but it wasn't like a big hit either.
Mm-hmm. We have different worlds, right? We have a jungle world, we have a rock world.
Yeah.
I think you got to pull something out of your ass again. I can't.
Warhammer Online.
Ooh, there you go. Why not?
Oh, no results found.
Oh.
Was Warhammer Online called something else besides Warhammer Online?
Or was it Warhammer: Online?
Well, someone in the chat says Neverwinter Nights, so I'm just going to say that.
Oh, okay.
Wasn't that? See, I feel like if I'd played this, I'd have known it by now.
With the like eyeball fire in the triangle, 100%.
Yeah, that's a pretty distinctive thing.
What the hell is that? That's great. Okay, so it is a PC game. Middling reviews. It's crazy that 80% is middling reviews, but I understand how it works. And we're back in like fantasy jungle.
I'm still thinking MMOs.
Yes, yeah, this has hard MMO vibes. That's why I'm still thinking it's a Warcraft thing.
I don't think it's World of Warcraft. I mean, I'll...
Yeah.
I put in World of Warcraft, but I don't think it's going to be that. Okay. Yeah, that definitely looks like an MMO to me, and it even says that it's an MMORPG.
What MMORPG is this? This is crazy.
It's not EverQuest, surely.
Sure.
EverQuest looked like crap. This looks way too nice for EverQuest. I almost think it might be Star Wars The Old Republic or Star Wars Galaxies.
Oh. With this much forest?
Everyone's in the chat saying Guild Wars 2, which I've never played. So if it's Guild Wars 2, then I wasn't going to get it. Everyone seems very certain that it's Guild Wars 2, actually.
Okay, all right. I'll believe you.
There you go. Thanks for helping my record, chat. Okay, one more, then we'll wrap it up.
This is great. This is a great game.
Well, it's a low poly 3D.
James Bond, Nintendo 64.
No, that's not Nintendo 64. It's not blurry enough.
It's not... Yeah, it's the way that they zoom and crop on some of these, it's definitely tough to add any context to it.
Yeah. Just going to pluck a guess out of my ass.
King's Quest
8, although that doesn't seem to be in the dropdown.
Journey of the Cursed King? Oh, that's Dragon Quest.
What, does this thing not remember King's Quest Mask of Eternity? Call yourself a video game expert. Well, I don't know. Just skip it. And it's too old for Metacritic. Great.
What the fuck is that? A statue? And it's snowing. A statue and it's snowing.
That looks like a pre-rendered cinematic to me.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
If it's too old for Metacritic, it's probably... And going by the graphics in the first one, that doesn't look like in-game graphics to me.
Right. Too old for Metacritic. I love that.
Dark Earth. Oh, and this thing hasn't heard of that either.
But it's all right, I'm just gonna
skip another.
Yeah.
Okay, original platform PC and the Nintendo 64. Is that a Star Wars
thing?
Oh, fuck.
This is a Star Wars. And the only 3D Star Wars they had on 64 was the pod racing game.
Are you looking at the chat?
I'm not looking at the chat. I remember that. Like, do you remember the yellow cartridge of the pod racing game?
I remember the game. I didn't remember it having a yellow cartridge. Yeah. Star Wars Episode One Racer. That was it.
Yeah. Yep. That's it.
Yep. There you go. Yeah,
because they didn't they they didn't have any other 3D Star Wars game for the 64, to my knowledge.
Hmm. Well, you probably know more about N64 games than I do, then.
Yeah, yeah. And I didn't know it was on PC.
All right, chat, that's your lot.
That's it.
We've overrun by a bit.
We have. This is fun. Yeah, no, this is like my morning, like during my wake up routine. I'll play this to get my brain.
Yeah, me too. Me too. I do the Wordle, I do the spelling bee, and I do the game guesser.
So fucking good. Thank you. It was Frost that showed it to you?
Yeah.
Thank you to Frost for enlightening us. Beautiful game.
But yeah, that'll be it from me. If you want to see my zero punctuation that was on Viewfinder and My Friendly Neighborhood, a 2-for-1, that went out on YouTube publicly today. If you'd like to see my review on Baldur's Gate 3, a little game called Baldur's Gate 3, you're going to have to be a member, I'm afraid. So either pony up the cash or wait a week for it to come out on YouTube then. Those are your options. And hey, just to sweeten the pot, what about a new episode of Extra Punctuation for members as well? Because that's dropping tomorrow.
Ooh. And if you're a member, hot off the presses on Saturday, you get a new episode of Adventure Is Nigh.
I haven't seen that yet. It's probably, probably not finished yet, haven't you?
It's not quite finished yet.
Okay.
we go right down to the wire with these, but
I'll bet, yeah.
It's a doozy of one, is what I will tell. I mean, all of them are doozy of ones because we were all together, they're all fun. But yeah, these are all the perks of being a member.
Mm-hmm. Well, the last one was mainly a lore dump, but you got to have some cheapo episodes to pad out the fun ones. That's how Game of Thrones always worked.
I mean, that's a doozy of a dump, is what I'll say. great. Yeah, all these things,
Anything else worth plugging coming out on the Escapers this week?
What? I'm sure there are, but I don't know what they are. If someone like our editor in chief was in chat and could mention them in chat right now, that would be helpful.
What's coming up later today? Someone will know. Oh yeah, at 4 p.m. Pacific time, there's Breakout.
Mm.
And then at 6 p.m. Pacific time, it's Jesse and Casey playing Assassin's Creed 4.
Boom! All the good things. All these wonderful things to watch and enjoy.
That'll be for today. And all sorts of content throughout the course of the week. And don't forget to watch the Sea of Stars documentary.
Yes.
I know Nick's very proud of that one.
Mm-hmm.
So that'll be it from us. So I will just say, see you all next time. Hope to see you all tomorrow for Extra Punctuation. Bye.
Bye, everyone.